In 1970, a television program debuted that changed the way millions of people looked at faith. The Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice.
Featuring the ministry of Robert Shula, taught a generation that through God's love, your scars can be turned into stars. It was an idea that launched the most popular, inspirational television program of its time. And today, the Hour of Power continues with a new voice for a new generation.
When you put your trust in God, nothing can stop you.
Pastor Bobby Shula will encourage you and share a message that can give you a new perspective on life. Because whatever your circumstance or the obstacles you face, this moment can be your Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
And welcome, family. We love you. Thank you for being here. It's a new year. One of my favorite quotes by Christine Kane is, just because the past didn't turn out like you wanted doesn't mean your future can't be better than you ever imagined. We serve a big God. Would you turn around and shake the hand of the person next to you and say, God loves you and so do I.
We are so glad that you're here today. Shepherd's Grove is a place that believes in the dignity of every human being. We know that whoever you are, that you're salt, you're light, that God is going to use you to make a difference in the world, that 2017 is going to be one of the greatest years ever because you're in it.
Amen.
And you're going to do good things in it. Amen? Good. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much that you've called us to this place. And I know that life can be very hard. So many of us who are coming here with worries and fears and big burdens, Lord, we just want to hold those out to you and say, take it, Lord. Lord, we want to go with your flow. And we're going to believe that this year is going to be great, that today is going to be great, and we're going to live every moment trusting you. And we pray that you'd form us into the image and person of Jesus Christ. We thank you. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I seek his hand of mercy, I
may be seated. In preparation for Bobby's message, the words of our Lord found in 1 Samuel. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and had him pass in front of Samuel. But Samuel said, "The Lord has not chosen this one either." Jesse then had Shema pass by, but Samuel said, "Nor has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse had seven of his sons pass before Samuel, but Samuel said to him, "The Lord has not chosen these." So he asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons you have?" "There is still the youngest," Jesse answered. "He is tending the sheep." Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." So he sent for him and had him brought in. He was glowing with health and had a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him. This is the one." So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. The world needs you. You have unique and significant gifts our world needs. Amen.
Show your power once Well, church, would you join me as a congregational prayer as we begin this new year? Father, we come before you at the start of this new year, and we start this new year in a spirit of thanksgiving. Lord, we look back on your faithfulness, and we say thank you. Thank you that you have been there. Thank you for your provision. Thank you for the fact that we can meet and gather in this place and worship you and praise your name. Lord, you have given abundantly to us, and we thank you for that. Your faithfulness stands. Lord, and as we look towards this next year, Lord, we pray and petition for those who are currently ill or sick or who can't be with us this morning. We pray for strength. We pray for your spirit to touch them in some new way. Father, we pray for all those who are serving our country, both foreign and domestic. We pray that your spirit guide them, that you be with them. Lord, we are particularly conscious of our new government and the government officials that are coming in. Lord, we pray for your hand to be ever guiding them as we look towards this new year. Lord, we pray for all of the mission activity going on throughout the world. We pray for open doors and God conversations to happen. We pray for blessings and blessings abundantly on those. Lord, and we pray for this church. We pray for our people, our congregation, Lord. We pray for a fire to be lit, a new passion for this city, a new passion for your word, a new passion for discipleship unto you. Lord, let Shepherd's Grove be just an incredible light to this community. May we ever proclaim your name. Lord, in all the resolutions and all the goals we have for this next year, may they all be glorifying to you. May you be at the forefront of all that we put our minds to, all that we put our hands to. And Father, we pray the way Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, every once in a while, we get to recognize someone special and bring someone up on stage and introduce you to them. And this morning, I am pleased to introduce actually one of our staff members, Amber Rodriguez. Would you come up here? Amber is 19 years old. She works in teleministry. So she is one of the people that when you watch the Hour of Power and see the phone number to call in, she is one of the people that answers the phone. And, you know, talking with teleministry, that's an interesting job because many people are pleasant and want prayer and just want to talk to someone, and some people aren't so pleasant. So it's a pastoral role, and I'm so thankful for Amber and all of our teleministry team. But Amber is going to Kenya later this week for just over three weeks on a mission trip. And so we wanted to pray for her as a congregation and commission her as a member of the Shepherd's Grove team. And one really cool story about Amber and what she means to this community. A few weeks back at a staff chapel, Amber was just a little bit short on fundraising. And so we opened it up to the staff and said, you know, we want to be a staff that rallies around Amber and what she's doing. And we want to, you know, help her get the final goal of what she needs to raise. And the staff came and in about 10 minutes, not only raised what she needed, doubled it. And so that will... that will tell you what an important piece of our community she is and how much we believe in her, and I know that you all believe in her as well. And so as we just pray for her on her journey, would you mind extending a hand towards her and just join me in this prayer for her? Father God, we lift up to you your servant Amber. Lord, we know that you have given her gifts beyond what she can even imagine, gifts to proclaim your word to this world. Lord, we pray for her upcoming trip to Kenya. Lord, we pray for doors to be opened. We pray for hearts to be softened. We pray for conversations to exist that would not exist without your power and your spirit being there. Lord, we pray for safety and travel. We pray for health. We pray for smooth connections and bus rides and car rides. Lord, we pray that you be in the midst of all of it. Lord, we pray that you fan aflame the gifts that you have given her and let her preach your word to her people. Let her be a comforting ear to your people. Let her bring your hope, your peace, your glory to all that she encounters. And as she is gone, Lord, let her know that this church, that this staff, that we are praying for her, that we believe in her, that we say, go, Amber, we are rooting you on. And we await your return and your good report. Lord, we love you. And we pray a special blessing over Amber this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, Amber.
I love this scripture. Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not grow faint. For 40 years, our Eagle supporters have been vital in keeping Hour of Power on air. This month, we celebrate our Eagle supporters and invite you to become one of our treasured Eagles. By saying yes to this invitation, you know that you are helping us to reach people all over Australia who need to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. As an Eagle, you'll give a monthly gift of $60, or you may choose to be a Gold Eagle and give $120 a month. To keep you connected throughout the year, you'll also receive our quarterly power packages containing inspirational, ministering and practical gifts, along with newsletters, printed messages from the Hour of Power, and other helpful positive materials. If you'd like to know more about becoming an Eagle, please contact us. We look forward to hearing from you. Please contact us on 1300 363 114 or write to us PO Box 1407 North Sydney 2059 or hourofpower.org.au, and you can find us on Facebook, Hour of Power Australia.
Thank you for joining us today here at Shepherd's Grove. We love you, and we want you to know we're there for you all the way. Whatever it is you're going through, we're with you. And we say this creed together. Would you hold your hands out like this as a sign of receiving? We're going to say this together. I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I'm the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. Thanks, you can be seated. So you may notice I'm wearing a robe, and I want to just say a few things about that before I begin my message this morning. When I was ordained as a pastor, there were all of these men of God I loved, and they came around, and my dad actually led the service, and they laid hands on me and prayed for me, and I wore this robe when that happened. And the robe became, and always has been, a sign of the idea that the person who is speaking has been affirmed by his or her community, has been educated, and has been prepared to do the task that God is at hand. This type of robe was put together in its roots by the Reformed doctors who wanted a sort of depth, or I don't want to say severity, but sacredness in the approach to serving the Word of God and the sacraments. So this robe has been worn by Dutch Reformed Presbyterian churches for centuries. And with the contemporizing of the church, many of the vestments and traditions that have us rooted in a history have been abandoned, in many parts because of the fear of religiosity and posturing, and some of those points really are valid. And yet on the other hand, I still see plenty of religiosity and posturing by cool pastors in jeans and t-shirts. So posturing is much more to do with the heart than it does with clothing. One of the big reasons I'm wearing this robe is because I want to be rooted in something deeper than myself, in a way. I am rooted in something deeper than myself, and we all are. And it's a reflection not of me as a person, but of the office that I didn't create, an office I inherited. And it's a way for me, as Paul says, to lift or raise the office to which I've been called. On a personal note, all the men of God in my life that I looked up to, most of them wore the same vestment, the pastors. My dad, a lot of people are like, what's it like growing up at the Christ Cathedral? I didn't grow up at the Christ Cathedral. I grew up at Rancho Capistrano Community Church, a Dutch Reformed church on a hill and on the sunny brown green hills of San Juan Capistrano. And we were there, and you know, every Sunday we had a choir, and my dad would come down wearing a robe like this, and he would preach the Word of God, and he always did this thing with children where he would sit down on the steps with kids and give them toys, and they're such fond memories. And we would go outside and have chili cook-offs and stuff. And when we came up to the Crystal Cathedral, the men of God there, like Tino Ballestero and Juan Carlos and my grandpa and Glenn and Jim and so many of the other pastors, men and women, wore the vestments as well as they would preach and administer the Word and sacraments. My parents were also divorced, and I went to church my whole life, but when I was with my mom, we lived in L.A., and we went to Hollywood Presbyterian, and so I would watch Lloyd Ogilvie preached in the exact same robe as well. And later on, we attended different churches that also had a huge impact on my life, mostly charismatic Pentecostal churches. But it's weird because that's really my life. I'm this odd combination of traditional Presbyterian Dutch Reformed, but also Pentecostal. And I'm this weird mishmash of the two. I think one of the main reasons I'm wearing this particular robe is that this is my grandpa's robe. It is the robe he wore. My grandpa, you know, I'm very close to my grandma and grandpa personally are here today. I'm very, very close with them. But I was also very close with my grandma and grandpa Schuler. Both of them have passed. And when I was a young college pastor with my grandpa Schuler, we would sit up in his office, and he mentored me for years. Every Thursday, I'd be up there for hours, and he would pour into me, and he'd ask me questions, and this and that. And I really idolized him. I really looked up to him. And I disagreed with him. I loved challenging him and pushing back, and I loved it when he didn't have an answer and would just smile. He'd just go. And he died 2 years ago. He gave me this robe. And he gave it to me because he wanted me to wear it. Excuse me. It seems wrong to let it sit in a closet. Excuse me. So, I'm gonna keep wearing the robe. And if it bugs you, if it bugs you, just pretend I'm giving a graduation speech and then you'll just get over it, you know? If it really bugs you, you can come to our modern service where I'll be a little bit more casual. So anyway, well, good morning. We're so glad you're here, and I'm so thankful that you're here to worship with us. And Shepherd's Grove is a church that really believes in people. Whatever it is you're going through right now, I really want you to know that the shame you feel, because we all feel it, we call shame different things. We call it embarrassment. We call it not good enough. We call it unworthy. We shroud it in pretending. I want you to know that here you can be safe. You can be exactly who you are. You don't have to wear masks in this church. You're loved just as you are, and not for what you should be, and not just by God, but by us. We love you very, very much. And we believe that this is the right kind of place. We believe the Hour of Power will always be a place where people can receive encouragement every day, be realigned with what God says and not what the world says, because the world can be really harsh. And we receive from God the good news that we are called, that we are beloved, that we're worthy, that we're talented. The possibilities of life are limitless, and that's a very good thing. The world needs you. Today we're beginning a series where we're going to talk about what Jesus said about life. Every couple of years, I love the Sermon on the Mount. I studied it for years and years. I've translated it from Greek to English. I studied under Dallas Willard, who was also a big Sermon on the Mount guy. And so I love to preach it, but I've done it to death in a way, you know. So I'm going to try, and in this series, pull from the Gospels a lot, but I'm going to move off of Matthew a bit. And we're going to talk about how Jesus gives you the opportunity to be totally alive. That when Jesus talks about eternal life, he's not just talking about going to heaven when you die, and he is talking about that, but he's also talking about how to be totally alive today. I want that. You want that too. And he gives us a roadmap for that. And so we're going to spend the next few months actually studying that, on how to be alive. Yeah, that's right. It's the narrow path, how to be alive. Jesus begins in the Sermon on the Mount by affirming that everyone in his audience is called, loved, powerful, and valuable. Now, this was remarkable in his day because the religious people in Jesus' day like to say some people are out and some people are in, and the way that you get in is by doing things the right way and not being sick. I hate to say that, but people like lepers and people with bleeding diseases, were believed to be cursed by God because of a sin of their parents or something like that. So there was this system in place where some people were in and some people were out. Jesus comes on the scene in the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 5, and he begins with the Beatitudes, in which he says that everyone belongs. He begins by saying, blessed are the poor in spirit. Being poor in spirit is not a virtue. That's a misunderstanding of the passage. Poor in spirit means you're spiritually bankrupt. Blessed are you if you mourn. Blessed are you if you've been a doormat your whole life. And Luke, he says, blessed are you if you're poor, if you're persecuted, if you're unwanted, if you're uninvited. Jesus says to these people, you are called, you are loved, you are light, you are salt. Now, I want to hang on that just for a minute. Many of us, we think that God always calls the brightest and the best. In 1 Samuel, the people of Israel don't have a king. They have judges and they have, but they always say God is our king. And in the story, the Jewish people decide one day that they want a king. And they pick this guy, Saul. Saul is regal, he's tall, he's handsome, he's kingly. He looks, acts, and sounds just like a king. They make him king. And he becomes a tyrant, he becomes an evil guy, he treats people poorly, and he's a terrible king. And then God tells Samuel, I'm going to call a new king. So he says, Samuel, go to Bethlehem, incidentally, where the family of the Jessies are. And Jesse's household is there. So go to Jesse's house, and when he arrives, Samuel the prophet, everyone in Bethlehem is scared because back then prophets weren't always bringing good news. And they said, are you here to condemn us? And he said, no, we're going to make a sacrifice together, which essentially means we're going to have a party. We're going to have a party and make a sacrifice to God. Now, the Bible doesn't say this, but I always believe that Samuel did this party sacrifice thing as a bit of a veil, a guise, to snoop around Jesse's family and see who the king was. Samuel was led by the Holy Spirit and was supposed to discern by listening and feeling from the Holy Spirit who this next king was, you know? So Jesse comes and he brings his son and he sees the eldest son, Eliab. He looks at Eliab and the Bible says, he looks and says, surely this is God's anointed. Because Eliab was tall, he was handsome, he was the eldest. He had all the things that made him look kingly. And the Bible says this, God said to Samuel, do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. The Lord looks at the heart. The Lord looks at the heart. So one at a time, all of these sons were brought before Samuel, and he keeps thinking, this is the one, and God says, no, that's not him, that's not him, that's not him. And finally, he thinks he's gone through all the sons. And Samuel says to Jesse, the dad, is this it? Are these all your sons? And it always breaks my heart, Jesse's response. He says, oh, well, he kind of scratches his head and goes, well, there's David. I mean, just hold on to that for a second. A big honor, a big celebration, a big party in a little town. If you've ever lived in a little town, a big party is a big deal. If the fair comes to town or something like that, everyone wants to go. David was obviously told, stay back, take care of the sheep. All of your brothers and I are going to the sacrifice. You get to stay. He's uninvited. Obviously, his brothers and dad don't see a whole lot in him. And Samuel says, we will not sit down until he is here. And when David comes, he's the chosen one because of his heart. And by the way, the heart is not all about emotions. In the Bible, the heart is about will. It's about what you choose to do. It's about courage. It's about being the one that in spite of not being the tallest, the best looking, the most regal, you say, yes, Lord, I say yes, I will do what you call me to do. It's about the heart. And David is anointed. And it says, when he was anointed, the Spirit of the Lord came upon him and remained with him. David was not a perfect guy. David made lots of mistakes, was even, in a way, a murderer. And in spite of that, God continued to use him to do a lot of good in the world. I don't have time to get into that story and explain why, but it's important to know that in our lives, we think of all sorts of reasons why God can't use us. We think of all of our flaws and sins and mistakes, and we explain to God over and over, God, you don't understand. I can't do that. Don't you know who I am? And you know what God says to you? He says, I know exactly who you are. You're my beloved child. You have everything it takes. You have everything you need, your salt and your light, and the world needs you. And I guess that's what I want to get across to you today. Very often in church, we talk about how God loves us and God wants us and God, but sometimes that can feel like, well, God wants us, but the world wants nothing to do with us. So the world doesn't need us. But Jesus says to these people, okay, so go back to the scene. Here's Jesus on a hill, and there's thousands of people, and most of them are riffraff and vagabonds and ragamuffins and all sorts of old terms. And he says to these outcasts who are not religious, who are probably there to get a miracle or see something cool happen, and he just says to them, you are light and you are salt. Something I really want to point out here. Notice how Jesus doesn't say to them, if you believe in me, you'll become the light of the world. I mean, it's true, we got to believe in Jesus, but he doesn't say that. And he doesn't say, work hard and become the light and the salt of the earth. Or he doesn't say, if you read the Bible, or if you do everything I tell you to do, then you'll be salt and light. What does he do? He just says, you are salt. You are light. That's what Jesus does. You notice how Jesus never prays for the sick? He heals sick people all the time, but he doesn't pray for them. When it's a leper, he goes up to the leper and he says, be cleansed. He doesn't say, God, please heal this leper. He just says, be cleansed. And he says, Lazarus, rise up and walk. And he says, be healed. She is not dead, she's sleeping. Jesus commands, he affirms, he says with his mouth things that aren't, and they become so. Incidentally, that's a big reason why I preach the way I do. Very often, I don't say, be stronger, I say, you are strong. I don't say, be righteous, I say, you are the righteousness of Christ. Because that's how Jesus preached. He didn't say, become the light of the world, become the salt of the earth. He said, you are the light of the world, you are the salt of the earth. And that is so important. It's positive affirmation and positive reinforcement is so much better than criticism. And yeah, there are times when we have to be critical, we have to work on things we don't want to talk about, but if it's possible, positive reinforcement is always better. Think about if you're at a party, and I've used this analogy before. Imagine you're at a party and there's Joe. This comes some guy named Joe who's super rude to everybody all the time. And there at the party, Joe opens the door for you just like it's once in a blue moon. He happens to open the door for you. You just stop for a minute. You say, Joe, you know, I just want to say I really appreciate you opening the door for me. I've had a rough day, and, you know, people oftentimes ignore you, but you open the door for me, and it probably seems like no big thing to you, but you're so polite and you're such a nice guy, and you're so just polite all the time. I really appreciate that. Thank you. And if you said that genuinely and it went along, you just watch how Joe, the rest of the night, is going to be like opening doors for people and washing dishes, right? Because when we see the best in people, we draw the best out of them. When we see the worst in people, we draw the worst out of them. There was someone in my family who used to call me clumsy all the time. I'm not a clumsy person. When I was around her, I was clumsy. I was messing things. And then she would say it again, oh, you're so clumsy. And I'm like, no, I'm not. And then knock a cup over. And that's the thing. When people speak over us bad things, it's so easy for us to lean into that and own it as a part of who we are. And when people speak good things into our lives, it draws the best out of us. Positive reinforcement, it's all about that. And so I want to say to you, that God is declaring that over you. Not that it's going to be so, but he needs you to know what's already there, that you're already salt, you're already light, you already have it in you. Just release it. Let it go. Open it up. Give it to the world. The world needs your salt and your light. Now, we're used to this phrase, salt of the earth, because we say it all the time. Oh, he's the salt of the earth. He's such a great guy. But Jesus invented the saying, and have you ever really thought about it? Like, why salt of all things? Like, why not something else? And there's a good reason for it. In the ancient world, Salt was very valuable. Everybody had a little bit of salt, but not much, because it was such a, it was like truffles, you know? It's like this thing that, you know, people didn't have a lot of. It not only tasted delicious, but it was necessary for life, because we don't realize, we, you know, everybody in this building has probably always had a fridge, except my grandma personally. She apparently had in the Ozarks a hole where she put ice and put, but anyway, I digress. In an age without refrigeration, the only way to preserve most food was to salt it. So you'd pickle stuff, and you'd need brine, salt water to do that. You'd salt your meats. So in order for a city or a civilization to grow, it needs access to salt, or else it can't preserve its food. It needs salt and it needs water. And so because of that, salt becomes this very expensive, valuable commodity. And actually, because it's so universally needed, becomes the main way that people are paid. Did you know that? Like, for a long time, Roman soldiers were paid in sol, or salary. That's where you get the term salary. Oh, light bulb, right? And you go on and on. I mean, there's salami is salted meat, salad is salted vegetables. There's other ones. Anyway, I go on and on. But the most important thing to know is that Christ is affirming in you how valuable you are. You're extremely valuable. And in the same way a town needs salt to exist and to eat, the world needs you. You're so valuable. He says, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, it's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. You have to ask yourself, have I lost my saltiness? Sounds like a pirate, doesn't it? Yarr, salty pirate. Have I lost my saltiness? Am I am salt, but am I being salty? Am I releasing all the flavor and the enthusiasm and the value that makes me who I am? You are salt, so be salty. And he says, you are light. And the light is knowledge, but light also in the Bible really is about being powerful. You know the old axiom, knowledge is power. Well, that was certainly true for the philosophical Jews and Greeks. They equated knowledge and power. So being light is a combination of both being powerful and being wise, or being knowledgeable. And he says, that's, you have knowledge. You have treasures in you that are so valuable. John Osteen, Joel Osteen's dad, who built that church into a mega church, I think he got up to like 6,000 people before he died and handed it off to his son Joel, preached in a church of like 200 people. I want to say it was like 30 years in a feed barn. And he was just faithful for all that time. And his other daughter, Lisa, said that one of the things that turned it around, that made it go from 200 to 6,000 quickly, is the Lord said to him, preach what you take for granted. Talk about what you think is obvious. See, that's the thing. You know so many things because it becomes such a part of you. You don't understand how they can be light, wisdom, guidance to other people. You're light. You're powerful. You're salt. You have everything this world needs to be better. You want to leave it better because God's called you to make it better. And one of the greatest things about this passage in Matthew is that the guy writing is a tax collector. And tax collectors are at the very bottom of the rung. They were thieves. They had sided with the Roman Empire. They were outsiders. Tons of shame. And Matthew, the tax collector, is writing about the Sermon on the Mount. And he's listening going, I'm not salt. I'm not light. And in the next chapter, Jesus walks up to Matthew and he says, you, Matthew, come follow me. You can almost see him knock over his table. He says, yes, Lord, I'll follow you anywhere you'll go. What an honor. Maybe you're like Matthew. Maybe you come here today and you go, I'm not salt. I'm not light. Bobby, you don't know what I've done. Or Bobby, you don't know how bad I've messed up. Or Bobby, I'm too old, or I'm not educated enough, or I'm too young. Or I've tried over and over and I just keep failing. Friend, I want you to know God is affirming today in your life. Your salt and your light and your best days are yet to come. Don't give up your hope. Don't throw away your tomorrow. Good things are coming. Amen?
Amen?
You are salt and light. You are salt and light. Confess it. Proclaim it. Believe it. Own it. The world needs you. What do you confess over yourself? Do you catch yourself? I mean, like, how often do we say, I'm such an idiot. Of course I messed up. I'm totally stressed out. I'm so worried. I'm, you know, these types of things. It's good to be vulnerable and it's good to talk about our feelings, but I'm talking about the ways in which we kind of compulsively say it. We're not sitting down with a cup of tea, opening up to a friend. We're just blurting out negative stuff all the time, negative confessions about ourselves and others. Stop doing that. Confess your sins, confess your mistakes, be vulnerable, be open, but don't just always compulsively say bad things about yourself. In fact, I would love for you to take a risk and one of these days when you're feeling stressed, just say something like, I'm feeling pumped, or I don't know what you'd say. I'm feeling relaxed, or I am the salt of the light, I'm the salt of the earth, I'm the light of the world. It feels weird even saying it, doesn't it? But that's what God says over you. Confess it. Not long ago, Hannah and I, maybe you're in a valley in your life, Hannah and I were in Switzerland and I took this cool picture. We'd always wanted to go here. We saw it on Pinterest. So we found it, this little house that is built on the side of a mountain. And actually the right side of that house is actually a mountain wall. So Hannah and I had to actually climb up there. You see all the snow. It was actually mid-June, I think late June. And the next day we almost got snowed in. It's only open during the summer. And it's very, very high in the Swiss Alps. And what that is actually, it's kind of like a glorified campground. So they have these little houses all over the Alps where mountaineers and hikers can stay the night and get shelter from the snow and won't, you know, die in it in something. The amazing thing is they had a bunch of food and beer. And I asked them, where did you get all this beer and sausages and stuff? Helicopter comes and drops it in. Anyway, that was cool. I digress. But this is up from a little village called Oppenzell. We were there doing ministry because of our Swiss office, and so we decided to take a few days extra. And it's a mountaineering town. And one of the things I noticed is that there's two people in the little mountaineering village. There's the villagers who are just always there. They're doing life. They're never going up in the mountains. And then there's the other person. There's the mountaineer in the valley. And the reason they're there is not to be bored and sit around and do nothing. They're there to prepare for the next climb. In other words, there's two people in the valley. There's some who are complacent or stuck or in the rut, and then there's another type of person in the valley, the mountaineer who's preparing, the mountaineer who's getting the right tools, putting the plans together, who's meeting the right people, maybe training or resting. And where you are in your life, you may say, Bobby, I've been in this valley for a long time, and I just want to say to you, you're in a time of preparation. You're not like the villagers who are going to be stuck there. You're the mountaineer that even though you're not on a mountain, you're getting the right tools. You're meeting the right people. You're resting. You're getting everything you need to get to the top. And I want to just say to you that God is going to bring you up to the mountain. If you're on the top of the mountain right now, nobody stays on top of the mountain, right? Unless you're dead. And the only people who stay on top of the mountain are dead people. So life is that ebb and flow. There's the up and downness of mountains, like the waves. That life is always a series of achievement and then letting go of your achievement so that you can achieve the next thing that God has for you. And that's a really great thing. So as we talk about how to be alive, we have to know that we are salt. You are salt. You're light, and the world needs you. Well, before we finish today, I always like to give everyone an opportunity to connect with God. And so I'm going to actually, today is a great day, you know, to become a Christian. What better day than today, right? We're thinking about the whole year is ahead of us. And maybe you're here today and you think, Christians are so religious or they're mean or they're judgmental. Those people are bad Christians. They're not the good kind, you know. And the world needs good Christians, like people that are not the bad kind, you know. And they need someone like you. And today is a fantastic day to become a Christian. So with everybody looking around, every head up, everybody just observing, I want to give you the opportunity today to become a believer. You say, Bobby, this is embarrassing. I don't want to be in front of all these people to do this. Look, the cool thing about becoming a Christian is it begins with an act of courage. And how much more courageous than to stand up in front of 1,000 people and come down and confess Jesus Christ? Are you at peace with God today? Are you at peace with yourself? If you need new life, I'm going to ask you now, right now, stand up and come down here and let me pray for you. Just in front of everybody. Who cares? You don't need to be cool. Just stand up right where you are, right in front of whoever it is, and come on down. Jesus says, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before the Father. But if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before the Father. I'm not here to condemn you. I'm here to love on you, to give you grace, and to give you an opportunity that when the day comes, when you breathe your last, that you know with confidence that you belong to Jesus Christ and you know where you're going, and to dedicate your life to serving him and loving him. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. So you want it? Come get it. It's a free gift. Thank you, friends. So we're going to pray together. And would you hold your hands out like this? And can I ask, do we have pastors and leaders? I want you to say this with me. And church, maybe when I became a Christian, I had an offer to come down, and I didn't actually go down, but I made a decision to believe in God that day. So maybe wherever you are, you're saying, I still want to make this decision. Let's all say this together. Would you, everyone, hold your hands out like this and repeat after me. Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I am now the righteousness of Christ. I am loved. I am forgiven. I am belong. I am called. And I am favored. Write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. And teach me to be like Jesus. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give them a hand. Thank you, guys. You are loved. You are called. You are blessed. You are above and not beneath. You are the head and not the tail. And so now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Was there something that you heard in today's service that you would like to know more about? Let us know by contacting us here at Hour of Power. We will send you a printed copy of today's message, and you could also request our current study guide that relates to the service you have just enjoyed.
Please contact us on 1300 363 114 or write to us, P.O. Box 1407, North Sydney 2059, or hourofpower.org.au, and you can find us on Facebook, Hour of Power Australia.
I love this scripture. Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not grow faint. For 40 years, our Eagle supporters have been vital in keeping Hour of Power on air. This month, we celebrate our Eagle supporters and invite you to become one of our treasured Eagles. By saying yes to this invitation, you know that you are helping us to reach people all over Australia who need to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. As an Eagle, you'll give a monthly gift of $60. Or you may choose to be a Gold Eagle and give $120 a month. To keep you connected throughout the year, you'll also receive our quarterly power packages containing inspirational, ministering and practical gifts, along with newsletters, printed messages from the Hour of Power, and other helpful positive materials. If you'd like to know more about becoming an Eagle, please contact us. We look forward to hearing from you. Please contact us on 1300 363 114 or write to us, P.O. Box 1407, North Sydney 2059, or hourofpower.org.au, and you can find us on Facebook, Hour of Power Australia.
If you have changed your address or other contact details, please remember to update the ministry with your new address, phone number, and email address. I'm Sam Haddon. And on behalf of all of us here at the Hour of Power, have a great week. God loves you, and so do we.